Well, Brian Hughes is going back so many years, it's without saying. When I was a young lad in my amateur career, young 11-year-old on the scene of boxing with my father, late Bob Shannon, Brian Hughes was there. So knowledgeable, so he just had a way about him. He's so cool, great knowledge, you know, a great trainer, and you know, sadly missed, because you know, where are you going to get another Brian Hughes from? You know, he's with all that experience, all that knowledge, you know, passing it down. It's I was upset, you know, but boxing's missed a great legend, and he's a legend in Manchester and all over the country and all over the world. Brian Hughes has some great fighters, you know, Pat Barrett, you know, and all the other fights he's had. But I can't name that many of them. But like you say, I hope in my career I'm as successful as Brian Hughes will be, has been, because that'd be a great achievement. And I've got a long, long way to go, but, you know, I'm dedicated. But Brian Hughes, you know, I've got a lot of respect for him. Sadly missed in boxing.
We've been your 50-odd years as a boxing coach. How did it all begin for you?
Well, it was like I say, you know, it was I saw these young lads fighting. It was a real vicious fight, you know, underneath the arches in the old Collyhurst flats. And I broke it up and stopped them. And I explained, you know, why don't you go into the lads' club? It's only around the corner. And they said, well, it's closed down now, you know, there's nowhere for us to go. So the following day, I couldn't believe that they, you know, it wasn't in the existence no more. I went round and I seen the warder called Mr. Noel Sykes, he was named. And he was a character in himself. He had a bald head and he was a big, tall, well-made fella. He used to be an headmaster at St. James's in Collyhurst. And he had a big moustache, like Gerald Nabrado, the old MP, I don't know if you remember him. Mm. Or Jimmy Edwards, he had this big moustache coming round. And he was a real character, you know. And he taught me into doing it, cut a very long story short. And it was like a challenge to me. I wasn't married, I was single, I was going out and we were, you know, drinking with mates. No, I didn't drink a lot, not at all. But I knew it was, you know, you can't keep a life up like this. And I agreed to do it. First of all, we started with the football, and that became successful. You know, we had Brian Kidd coming in training, and he could have been a good light heavyweight, you know, but Matt Busby stopped him.
Training with Brian at first, Brian's the person who's made me the fighter I am today. He has taught me how to respect people, not only just in boxing, out in my life as well, and he's done a lot for me. And the way he taught me in there and taught me how to keep watching the videos. You got skill. It's skill that wins you fights. You know, when you get to that top level, it's the skill that wins you fights. You need the circuits and you need the running and that to get you fit. But always work on your skill, and that's what he drilled into me. And that's obviously keep learning. And that's why I always watch things and stuff like that. And now I think I'll train with anyone better than I have with Brian. He was the best trainer I've ever trained with.
Well, we didn't, you know, we all we had was full of enthusiasm. We had no money. The club had no money. And these old times said, get an old kit bag. That's what we used to have years ago. It was Jack Bates, actually, who said it. Fill it up with all straw and put some, what they call it, all clothes in and all that, and hang it up, and it'll be all right. And the fellow that I told you about, who was in charge, Mr. Sykes, he was an old headmaster, and he used to have this booming voice. You know. He said, put a bit of wet sand in it, and it won't move, you know, with it being eye down, they'll punch it, and it won't move all over. So we did this, like, you know, but what happened was, you know, they didn't have the proper bad gloves. We had no money, you see. So when they punched it, all the knuckles would come up and be cut and what have you. And it was this particular, and the first night we must have had 60-odd people in. Honestly.
It was a real success then.
Oh yeah, it was. And he comes in, Sykes, and he said, gather round, children, come around here now. He said, and I'm trying to say, because he said, as an ex-RAF boxer, which I knew was a load of codswallop, you know what I mean? I had my good times when I boxed in the RAF championships during the war, and he's going against the Bantam, and he was like, what do they call it, Charlie Chaplin, or one of the old timers. He's going to punch the bag, and I'm trying to say, no, don't. They're all banging their hands up like, Brian, please, I'm just going to say these few words and then we'll be finished. And he let fly at the bag on his hand. You could feel all the thing in his hands, the nerves and everything going. And it come up there, I could see it, like, you know, and he said, right, boys, carry on now, he said. And don't forget, he said, there's a terrible smell in here. None of you have had a shower. Or you did. Well, there was no showers. There was showers in the gym, like he said. Make sure you have a good shower and bloody well wash yourselves down. Hey, this little kid out of the back shouting, fuck off. Who said that? Bring that boy to me. And he rushed down the stairs, dashed out, and we was at the top of the thing, just over the other side, to say that we could see down below where his office was, and looked through the window, and we saw him rolling on the floor, all his hand. The next day, he had it all plastered. He must have broke his hand or something. Well, they were the laughs that they all had, you know what I mean? It was characters. It was brilliant. We had kids whose dads was rag and bone men and what have you. And they was bringing us stuff, like old stuff that they'd found or they'd got from the bins and all that, you know what I mean?
So people help you along the way.
Oh, it was brilliant. Build it up. The atmosphere was tremendous. That's what I'm saying. We had that Busby Babes ethic that they had, where it was all for one and one for all. And we built up, you know, a good following. They follow us all over. It was brilliant.
First and foremost, Brian Hughes is an absolute gentleman. Always has been, always will be. And he's paved the way for people like me, you know. He's put Manchester on the map, you know. He was the first one to remember training boxers, you know. And I remember when I was boxing, he had a kid called Kid Sadler. And he was just coming through, and that was kind of where I met Brian, you know, in the early days, when we was boxing for Jimmy the Weed and Brian Robinson and Jack Trickett, you know, in that era, in that old firm, you know what I mean? And I met him down at the Jimmy Weed's pub in Salford, the Brown Bull. It was the opening night, and they actually brought a fucking Brown Bull. A big bull, you know, like they would, wouldn't they? You know, why wouldn't you bring a big giant bull to a pub opening? And I had a good chat with him there, and then I kind of lost track with him, but I always knew that he trained the kids like Gomez and people like that, and Pat Barrett and all them lads, you know what I mean? And really looked after the kids, and, you know, he was like a father figure to him, you know, a little bit like I am with Brian. But, you know, I aspire to be like people like Brian Hughes. If I can finish boxing and people say the same half about me, what they've said about Brian, I'll be very lucky.
The first night that they had fights back again, it was the first time since Jack Bates' day where they actually had boxing. And the first lads we had was George Kite had his first fight for the club, and Roger King, a young black heavyweight we had. And they boxed at Middleton Baths. The police used to put them on then. Police used to put amateur shows on. And when I got there, like, this policeman, two big policemen on the door, said, hey, I said, oh, Collyhurst. He said, Collyhurst? He said, there's about 50 of them gone in. He said, they can't all be fighting, can they? I said, oh, no. He said, oh, God, I saw them, get them out. Well, they couldn't, like. They must have all walked through and said, I'm with Collyhurst. The two of them won, which was good, and that set the tone for the rest of the time. Then a bit of success. That's all you needed. Give them confidence, and then it was right.
Like 60-odd kids turning up on the first night. It was a real cause for it. Brian, wasn't they, on the estate?
It was brilliant, honestly. Yeah. If I can find you one of these booklets we had done, it was in the 60s that we did it, and it shows you some pictures of us all. You'll see, well, you won't recognise me on it, but it was good.
Talking of the Busby Babes, I know Brian Kidd was one of the kids who'd walked in to the gym as well. Was he a good boxer? Could have made it as a boxer before.
Oh yeah, he could have been a good light heavyweight, seriously. He used to train with the lads, and he was always there supporting us, you know. wherever they boxed, if it was local, he'd come. You know, unless they had midweek games and all that, obviously he couldn't come. And we started with the football and we started winning leagues and cups and what have you. And it became very successful all round. In fact, the head policeman in Willett Street, which was only across the road from the club, he used to come in and say, oh, the crime rate has dropped down alarmingly. Keep it going, you know, and it was great. And we wanted to help the kids as well. You know, I'd been born and bred in Collyhurst, so I knew how tough it was, you know, and what have you. And I knew the flats there was, you know, they'd been built very quickly during the war years. And they pulled them down in the 60s, later on in the 60s, you know. Well, then we started the boxing, and that was even more successful than the football. And we won loads of amateur titles, you know, and we travelled all over. We used to go to Birmingham on a Saturday night as well, you know, in the old car factories that was, prevalent then, you know. There was loads of car factories, and they put the shows on a Saturday night, and I'd take lads up, you know, in an old minibus and did all box, you know. But the main thing what I wanted to do was I wanted them to be different than the ordinary boxers that I'd seen. You know, and I wanted them to have that flair, but especially even if they got beat, where I knew that they wouldn't come with, marked up faces and what have you, and badly beaten and all that. So I insisted that we work and train on counter punching and defensive work, you know, slipping punches and sidestepping and what have you. And it did, it came off for us, you know, it was lovely. And I used to write to people all over England and America, and Bobby Neal was a great help to me, you know, the old British featherweight champion who managed a lot of top-class boxers like Alan Rudkin and Johnny Pritchett and so forth. And they all advised me on different things and what have you. And I listened to it all, but then put it into my own way of thinking. And we turned out, you know, really good, like Kenny Webber, like you say, Winston Cousins, Delroy Wall, and fighters like that. It was brilliant.
That gym had previously been run for years by Jack Bates. I mean, I was a real someone who you looked up to. Had he passed on then, and the gym had just sort of closed down?
Yeah. Well, what he did when I was a kid, Jack Bates used to have the gym on Rochdale Road. It was at the side of a barber shop, a famous hairdresser's that all the Manchester United players used to go to, and he was called Larry Toft, the owner of the shop, and he gave this room at the side of him as a gym to Jack Bates. So I used to look, scratch the thing on the window because it was all painted over, so you could train in privacy. Like, it was on the main road. Until one day, this old boxer, Tommy Fine, that lived in the next street to me, he said to me, "Come on in." I was only about 11 then, and I went into the gym and saw them all training, you know. And Frank Johnson, the British lightweight champion, Tommy Proffitt, who was a brilliant bantamweight, Neville Tetlow, Owen Trainer, and, different fighters.
Jackie Braddock was...
Yeah, Jackie brother. Braddock was Frank Johnson's brother. And there was loads of them. And then, I don't know what happened, whether that became condemned, but Jack moved up to what they call the Rainbow Gym, and him and Tom Hurst, who was Bruce Woodcock's manager, I think joined up to part own the gym. It was called the Rainbow Gym then, and it was at the back of a big pub on Queens Road called the Big Queens. And I went in there, and I used to sweep up for Jack, and he'd give me half a crown, which was a lot of money in them days, you know. And I used to watch him all training, and then he said, "You've trained yourself as well, you know," and he used to give me all tips. And I watched him coaching these lads. And people like Frank Johnson was absolutely, the skill that he had was unbelievable. And he always very skillful. And it was when the Jamaican people started coming over to England, there was two of them came there. Del Willis, one was called, who turned pro. He was a good fighter. And I remember this Johnny Kingston Elliott, his name was, but he moved into the Midlands somewhere. But he was a brilliant fighter, you know, boxer, amateur boxer, and what have you. And I think his son turned professional, and I'm not sure whether he didn't become a British champion. you know, in the 70s and what have you. Anyway, they was the type of fighters that was there, and I used to watch them. And I remember one day that Jack Bates said to me, if you keep training, Brian, honestly, he said, you know, you'll get a licence. And I was only 16 then, but you could turn pro at 16. And to be honest with you, although I might have left school, where I was a dunce, I must be truthful, I had the street smarts to know that I wasn't good enough for that, and I'd get absolutely murdered. Yeah. So I listened to him, like, you know, and some of the others, like Neville Tettle, all of them said, hey, Brian, don't you kid yourself that he's only saying it to boost you up. He turned you pro. I thought, oh, no way. And Johnny Butterworth used to go. And Johnny Butterworth was a real tearaway fighter. If he was going today, he'd be worth a lot of money, because his style was... He was like a Ricky Hatton of that period, but he was a real puncher and everything.
Exciting.
Oh, brilliant, honestly. He had loads of fights at Liverpool Stadium. They loved him there, the Liverpool supporters, and Johnny Best, who was the promoter, oh, wanted him on his bill every time he had, you know, he put one on, which was every month. And he beat some really good fighters, you know.
Well, that Rainbow Gym was really bursting with talent then.
Oh, brilliant, honestly. It really was.
So like early 60s.
Yeah, Stan Skinskis was there. And and there was a mate of mine that lived in the next street to us called Andy Lambert. And he turned pro at 16, but he was a real tough fella on the street as well as in the ring. And I think he only had a pro career for about 2 years, but in that short space of time, he had 40-odd pro fights. He was burnt out. And his dad had been an ex-boxer. And he started talking. I remember it, you know, as I walked home with him. I used to walk home with him because he only lived around the corner. And his father was saying, you should tell Jack Bates, you know, that you should put you in with Dave Charnley. Now, as sick as I was at school, I knew my boxing and analysed it. And I read about Dave Charnley as an amateur and pro, and I said to Andy, don't fight him. I said, oh, he's brilliant, he's a southpaw. I said, he won't suit your style, mate, believe me. But his father was insisting that Andy tell Jack Bates to get him a fight with him. Thank God it never came off. And he finished within 2 years, Andy. Just packed it in, he'd had enough of it, you know what I mean? Not because he held the record for a long time of scoring the quickest knockout at Blackpool Tower. Yeah, it was at Blackpool Tower. He knocked out this fella called, I think it was Billy Skelly, knocked him out within so many seconds. He had a belt in right hand, you know, he used to move it like that, even outside before he threw it, like, and he was a character, a real character on the street as well as anything. And I learned from all them. And I used to go to these other gyms, just visit them and see how they was training and who was coming through and what have you, you know. And like I say, we all, you know, if you don't go in and learn something, even if it's good or bad or indifferent, you've got to learn something. It's no good you going in and just seeing. You know, you've got to learn from them. And I took those thoughts back with me to the gym. And we used to train every day in the old Collyhurst gym at Willetsey, trained every night. And then we'd go in every weekend as well, you know. If I thought that some of them needed extra training, we'd go in every weekend. Yeah. And we produced and we preached this defensive work, you know. But you've got to be exciting as well. And we put these tournaments on at St. Edmunds Club. We put a big one on at St. Pat's and St. Pat's Hall. We brought an Irish team over, you know. Then we brought a Danish team over, and it was really going well. I had no thoughts at all about turning professional. The reason I did turn professional was because a lot of the lads that had turned pro used to come back and tell you that, oh, I'm not happy with this fella, you know, or the managers at that time, and we're not seeing the proper money and so on, and we're not getting paid right and so on.
Yeah.
And he says, you come with us, like, you know, and we know. And I learned how to, I used to, because like I say, I was single then. And I got to know Eddie Thomas. who was the manager of Howard Winston and Ken Buchanan, and they used to go and spend time in Wales, in South Wales, down in Merthyr Tydfil. And I saw how they trained. And the one thing I realised, that two of them became world champions, Howard Winston and Ken Buchanan. But the way they sparred, this is only my opinion now, you know, but a lot of people that live in Wales and in Merthyr tell me that now, even now, because I keep in touch with a lot of them, you know, and it was vicious. They was better fights than what you'd actually see in a ring, you know, in a proper tournament. And I thought, surely that's got to be taking something out of them, sparring like that, all out, you know. And I seen the same thing in London and so on. So I'd never let our lads at Collyhurst, I'd never let them go all out when sparring, unless it was somebody that we brought in from another gym who wanted to have a, you know, a different spar and what have you. Then, you know, we'd try everything out, like, you know. But the main thing was, we wanted to have this, like, same thing that the Busby Bays became through Jimmy Murphy, you know. And that's what we tried, a lovely family atmosphere. And it was brilliant. It was one for all and all for one. And that's the system that we had. It was lovely.
Jimmy Murphy was a real influence on your life.
Oh, he was brilliant. Him and Jack Bates and, yeah, and Eddie Thomas, to be quite truthful, you know. And, yeah, they was like a big influence on us completely. And I used to watch and study these. I must have been the first coach to buy a video recorder when they came out. And I definitely know I was the first coach who, with a video recorder, I got that NTSC that you could switch a button and it show you the American tapes. And in America, they used to send me these tapes over, and I seen these great fighters like Wilfredo Gomez, Alex Aguelo, and all fighters like them, Salvador Sanchez, and all the great fighters in America, you know. And I studied the style. And if I saw that, say there was a big tall lad, a lanky kid that was about a light heavyweight, something like that, I'd copy Bob Foster, some of the moves Bob Foster had, you know, the way he stood side on, and he'd bring that jab up, not from that position, throwing it out, but coming from the knee. You know, I'd study Bob Foster and analyse him. And if I had a big, tall, lanky lad like him in that weight division, I'd teach him. Instead of him coming side on, throwing the jab from there, he'd bring it up like Foster did, like a whip. Boom! And it was brilliant. And he'd study it, practice it week after week. And then we'd bring somebody in for him to spar with. And he'd try it out, and you've got it. If there was a smaller fella, like a bantamweight, like Craig doing them, we'd show him films. Or I'd get video from America of, say, Willie Pep, or that Salvador Sanchez, or somebody that was bringing Wilfredo Gomez, and all them, and we'd practice them moves, them hooks that they threw, you know, where they drop over and throw the hook up, and the way the Mexicans threw it long ways, and we'd practice all them moves completely, and it was absolutely brilliant, honestly.
One thing I want to say, and one person I really do want to thank for giving us all of this, is Brian Hughes, and I'll tell you why. Because being a trainer I am today, yeah, I learned everything from one of the best trainers around. And I mean one of the best trainers around. I went worldwide, everything. And he was one of the best. And I'm still learning now. But my experience came from everything that Brian had and told me about having the patience with fighters like Reese. Yeah. And your talent will come. Don't ever give up and don't ever think that they're what you've got. And that perseverance and waiting for Reese for it to come, it's come at the right time, and it couldn't have come at a better time. And we both really want to thank Brian, because without Brian, he wouldn't be where he is today, and I wouldn't be where I am today. And that was, you know, the best thing ever.
But one of the things we had to do early in the career as well was when we first started off, like, you know, there was no money. So to gain things, you know, you had to try and get a bit of sponsorship, which was dead hard in the early 60s and all that. So one time Andy Cooper was coming to speak at the Anglo-American Sporting Club in the Piccadilly Hotel. So I phoned that bass up who organised it, and I said, listen, Do you think there'd be any chance to get this young kid called Keith Agambar? He's been picked for England to go to America, and they've hardly got any money, you know, to buy him any clothes or out. I said, but do you think any? Yeah, no problem. Come down. This was the Sunday. He said, come down tomorrow morning, he said, and Henry will bring his three belts down. He said, you get your picture taken with him. So I phoned up Mrs. Smith, that used to write for the East Manchester Reporter. And she came down, like, and she sent a photographer down. And we had this picture, me, the Keith Agambar, Nat Basso and Henry Cooper, with the three belts. And a few days went by, like, he took the picture, and Mrs. Smith phoned me up and said, hey, Brian, oh, these brilliant pictures of you, you want to see them? He said, but the editor wants to know a story needs to go with the picture. Did Henry Cooper, I must have had a conversation with Henry Cooper. I said, oh, yeah. And I thought, oh, what can I say, like? So I said, oh, he told us that he lives near Wembley Stadium, and that if we was ever down London way, we must call in to see him at his house. And his wife would give the kids a drink of mineral and a sandwich and let them see his amateur trophies and what have you, and do. I said, and a few weeks went by and he had Kenny Webber, who had turned professional then, and I was taping his hands up and he was boxing at the Royal Albert Hall. I said, and it was down like in the cellar part, and it was only like a light bulb in, and I bent over Webber taping him up, and I got this tap on the shoulder. And it was three big fellas behind me with overcoats on and dark glasses on. I couldn't recognise who they was, like, but I thought it was something to do with the craze. And I thought, Jesus Christ, what's happened here? He said, well, can you just step outside? And I went outside and I'm trying to say, hey, listen, I don't know what your problem is, like, but I'm just down here with a boxer, like, you know, what's going on? I said, and Emily Cooper took him off, like, and I thought, oh, thank God for that. But what's happened? And he pulled this letter out of his inside pocket and he read it out to me. Dear Mr. Cooper, I've just read in our local paper that you've invited these Collyhurst kids to your house. You'll be absolutely sorry that you've ever done this. These are a load of robbing bastards that you could ever get. They'll pinch all your trophies, they'll pinch all your wife's diamonds or whatever she's got, jewellery, and they'll wreck your house. Don't have nothing to do with them. He said, look at this. He said, I've had loads of letters like this, you know what I mean? So, to be honest with you, I had to start laughing then, like, you know, and I thought, oh, thank God for that. I thought it was someone said, but that was just to help somebody out, you know, to get him a bit of sponsorship. Unfortunately, he got in with the wrong crowd, and he wasn't as dedicated as what he was when he started. But he won the European title in fantastic fashion. I don't know if you've ever seen the film of his knockout of that fella. Well, I thought he killed him.
Oh, he's got him. He's got him. And Calamati is knocked cold and the referee is not even bothering with the count. It's over. Pat Barrett is the European light welterweight champion. But more immediately, the concern must be for Calamati's health.
And he should. And it's his own fault that he didn't become a world champion. And then we went to a thing before Thomas Hearns boxed Sugar Ray Leonard for the first time. He asked me to drive with him, Stuart. We went to this garden party. His publicist, Jackie Callan, she put this do on in the yard like a barbecue. It was boiling in the summertime. And when we went, he said to me, listen, Brian, I like the way you coach, I like everything, he said. Would you like to come and work over here with me?